Unfortunately, only three of you, but I want to. by the way, results of the midterm were not so good as I expected. You are champion. Average is about 10 points. So it's 50%. It's not so terrible as I expected. Now look, there are some problems are rather standard, but two of them you did not solve. So I'm going to consider these two problems with you rather quickly. First, again, about this Henstock-Kurzweil integral, generalized Riemann integral. Please try to understand how to construct this function delta. It's the same as in calculus of first year. Students can understand how to find the limit. They cannot prove that this indeed is the limit in terms of epsilon delta language. It's just epsilon delta language, but on another level, since here delta is not a number, it's a function. So again, look, we have that number I. By the way, what was the problem? So this is problem one. Problem one, function fx, I'd like to recall you, was was what? Natural logarithm x for x from the interval irrational on the interval 0, 1, and it is 0 for rational x. And the question was to, of course, it's not Riemann integrables, clearly that set is discontinuous. We consider this function on the interval 0, 1, in the interval 0, 1. Since the set of discontinuity it is the whole interval, so measure of the set of discontinuity is positive. Therefore, we have that function, of course, is not Riemann integrable, but it is generalized Riemann integrable. And what is the generalized Riemann, the value of the integral? If you will neglect this, indeed, if you will replace by, instead of 0, we'll take the same logarithm for rational. Of course, it will be very standard integral, and you can calculate this integral by parts, and you will have value 1. So this is only the candidate for value of generalized Riemann integral. So what should we prove? We want to prove the following, that for any epsilon, there exists delta. Now delta is a function. Delta of t positive such that delta maps from the interval 0, 1 to the, it cannot take zero value, strictly positive, such that, what do we have? We have that this value, f of ck, and here delta xk minus the value of integral, in our situation, plus 1, summation k from 0 to n minus 1 is smaller than epsilon for any tagged partition P. What does it mean, tagged partition? Tagged partition is the following. We have 0, x0 less than x1 less than etc. So this is the same as for usual Riemann integral. But now we have that ck belongs to the interval xk plus 1. And what is more, the most important here, that the length of this interval, delta xk, which is xk plus 1 minus xk, is smaller than delta of ck. So of we are, our problem is to show delta, yes? And now, you will suggest me any partition, but with this condition. And my problem to show that for this partition, this very concrete finite sum, plus 1, this value is smaller than epsilon. I forgot to take new board markers. Now look. Of course, we cannot take here, we considered with you some examples, of course, we cannot take here delta rk equals 1 for any rational rk, since rational are dense, rational and dense on the interval, and for any partition, I can choose this rational, and the corresponding value of the sum will be 0. Of course, it does not work. If we take that our function f of x, it is something non-zero, if x is not rational and zero, it is not rational, and if x is rational, then of course in this situation integral will be 0. Generalized Riemann integral will be 0. And of course, in this situation, we easily can take this delta, since it's not important for the value of the integral. Okay? It's not important for the value of the integral. Now, wait a minute, or maybe inverse. Inverse, yeah. So this is zero and this is not zero. Now look, but in our situation, no. Just in correct way. So if we take irrational, then it is zero, okay? So what did we do with you at the beginning? At the beginning we proved that integral from 0 to 1 to characteristic function of the generalized Riemann integral is 0, dx is 0. So what was the calculation? What was the delta? For delta we choose, right. We take delta of t is 1 for irrational. T is not rational, since it's not problem, the value of the function, and delta of Rn, it was epsilon divided by 2n, for t is rational. So, now look, here situation a little bit inverse, since now this it takes zero value at rational points. So, what do I suggest? It seems to me we discussed this with you somehow, that if we want to exclude some point, for example, in this situation, what is the picture? In this situation, we have this function. So we want to prove that this is minus 1. We want to exclude this point. It is first remark. What should we do? We have to take delta t always smaller than t for any t. Then what do we have from here? From here, look at the first condition. Then we have that. Then it follows that c0, it must be x0, it must be 0. Why? Because we have that x1 minus x0, which is x1, it is smaller than delta of c1. Oh, delta of c0. It's smaller than delta of c0, okay? But if you use this condition, this delta of c0 will be smaller than c0, and then we will have a contradiction. This is x1, and this is x0, this is x1, so we cannot take point any of that type. So definitely we have to take delta of c0. If you take delta of c0 some positive value, then we will not have a contradiction. Okay? Do you see this or not? Since otherwise we will have that x1 is smaller than we have interval. This is x1, this is smaller than delta c0, yeah? Now this is value. Of course it's impossible, since this is x1 and this is c0. So only the chance is to take delta c0 equals x0. If we will do this, we exclude some first interval, So this will be c0, this will be point x1, and now there are no problems with these points, since the corresponding part of the sum is 0. Now, so let's just start from this first step. That is what we will do. We will fix epsilon. Here you go. Imre, good, no? Okay, I will write by it. Fix epsilon. Take given epsilon. Take delta 0 equals delta at point 0 such that We will neglect this part. If we will neglect this part, it means we can do this if this area is small. Since this total area is 1 up to sine minus, you see, if you can neglect it, it should be smaller than epsilon, no? Smaller than epsilon over 2, smaller than epsilon over 4, okay? This one. Of course, we can do this, because if we consider usual Riemann integral, then this integral converges, therefore this area is as small as we want. If you will take the small x1, okay? Now, therefore, we will take delta 0 such that integral from 0 to delta 0 of modulus of logarithm x dx is smaller than epsilon. Oh, it seems to me it's better to take immediately epsilon over 4 at the beginning. Once more, why can we do this? We can do this since we have that integral from 0 to delta 0 of logarithm of x. You can find easily. It is x logarithm x minus x from 0 to delta 0. So this is something as a delta and here logarithm delta minus 1. So of course it is, it goes to 0. It goes to 0 as delta goes to 0. Okay? Therefore, we can take it. We can take it. Okay? We can do this. Now, for the rest, for this part we have very good function. We have here some value m. We have some value m. M it is the logarithm of delta 0. We have function which is bounded, bounded function. Now, just logarithm. Let's consider logarithm at the beginning. Logarithm x is bounded on this interval 0, delta 0, 1. So we have usual situation with Riemann integral. For Riemann integral, in principle, we can show this explicitly. Maybe no need to do this. Since it's Riemann integrable, then for any for given epsilon, there exists delta as a number. Delta is a number such that the corresponding sum plus 1 minus this part, which is small enough, will be smaller than epsilon. Okay? So once more, look what I want to say. I want to say the following, that integral from delta 0 to 1 of logarithm. Now consider usual Riemann integral. This is usual Riemann integral dx. It is, what is this? This is minus 1. This is integral from 0 to 1 minus integral from 0 to delta 0. So this is minus 1. We understand this minus 1. And minus integral from 0 to delta 0. Therefore, what do we have? We have that this Riemann integral from delta 0 to 1 logarithm x dx plus 1. It is smaller than this integral. It is epsilon over 4. So we have situation that this integral now, only on this interval, proper integral, can be replaced by partial sum. So given epsilon now, given epsilon take, we can take delta, let it will be delta 1, such that the corresponding integral sum, now, plus 1, will be smaller than epsilon over 2. We will lose something, but now we will have that here f of ck, it's not f, it is logarithm. It is logarithm ck and here delta xk from, it's not, maybe it's better to write now tk. Tk plus 1 will be smaller than epsilon over 2. I replace this usual Riemann integral by concrete Riemann-Darboux sum. Now, what are this tk? Summation here I don't want to specify. Since tk here, delta 0, it is t0 smaller than t1, etc., smaller than tn, tm equals 1. Okay, so there exists. Why? Because this is from 0 to m minus 1. Once more, because this is Riemann integrable, so we can replace integral by Riemann sum with any precision. Yeah, it's smaller than epsilon over 2. Please, your questions about this step. And now it is all, it's almost all, since, indeed, we can show this delta in this situation explicitly, because we will have it if the oscillations, the sum of oscillations of the function will be smaller than this epsilon over 2, yeah? So what, if we take oscillations of logarithm x on the intervals ik, so these intervals ik given by this tk, if it is from 0 to m minus 1, if this oscillation is smaller than epsilon over 2, then it's okay. Yeah? So what is oscillation? We have concrete interval ik, and oscillation, it is the difference between maximal value of the function, minimal value of the function on this interval. But for this oscillation, it's not difficult to estimate, yeah? Because this is logarithm. Look, it is logarithm. So, of course, if you have interval here x and here interval plus x plus some delta, then this difference, it is logarithm of x plus delta minus logarithm of x modulus, yeah? Oscillation. Corresponding oscillation, it is the modulus, this that one, yeah? And now, this is by mean value theorem. It is 1 over some theta derivative, multiplied by delta, yeah? And this is the theta here is smaller than 1 over x, yeah? It is smaller than 1 over x. So this is 1 over x, and here the corresponding delta. delta OX. So we can estimate this distillation. We can estimate this distillation. Therefore, what we will have? We will have, if you want to have this, that if this is smaller than epsilon over 2, if this is smaller than delta, I mean this capital delta is smaller than the delta 1 that we are going to choose, then we will have that, what do we have then, by the way? It is oscillation, and I forgot to write here delta, length of the interval. And the length of the interval ik, this should be smaller than epsilon over 2. And then we will have that this is smaller than delta. So we will have that the sum, and here we have the length of the interval 2 times, length of the interval squared divided by x. And x is smaller than m. X, of course, x is larger. X is smaller than 1 over delta 0, since x more or equal than delta 0. So this is 1 over delta 0. 1 delta I will put in front of. And for the second sum, it is just the sum of lengths of intervals, ik. Sum of lengths of the intervals, it is delta 1 over delta 0, 1 minus delta 0. We will neglect this stuff. So it is just delta 0 explicitly. Delta 1 can be taken, for example, as delta 0, which is fixed now. Epsilon was fixed at the beginning, divided by 2. It's also important since this delta 1 exists. Delta 1 exists since this function is Riemann integrable. But for this situation, we can show it explicitly. Yeah? And now, questions? Now, what the last? What the next? So, this is 0. This is x1. We don't know where is the delta 0, but x1 is smaller than delta 0. Yeah? Now, so maybe here there are some in order, x2, x3, etc., up to xm. And now the last xn, which is 1. So this is 1, this is xn. And we have a function. Now we are ready to write the corresponding sum, f of ck and delta xk with, just for any partition. Suppose that what we try to understand, what do we want from delta? What do we want from delta t, from this function? From this function, which will define the partition, yeah? From now we take summation not from 0, from 1 to n minus 1. Why? Oh, because for 0, I'd like to recall you, that c0 equals 0 and f of 0 equals 0. So the first term is 0, yeah? Now, and now we have here plus this 1. So we want to prove that this is small, yeah? This is small. How can we do this? I suggest the following. We can, instead of this function, which is not a logarithm, first of all, we can write that this is the summation f of ck delta xk plus 1 for ck is not rational. If ck is not rational, since if it's rational, the corresponding term is 0, function is 0, yes? Now, but now instead of f, of course, we can write logarithm, since for rational it is logarithm. And now I think that we can do the following. We can write now, again, we can return to summation for all from 1 to n minus 1 logarithm now ck, yes, delta xk plus 1. And of course, since here I add some terms, I have to subtract them. What are these terms? These terms are the sum of logarithm of ck delta xk for ck are rational. Okay, so once more. I add this term to that stuff, and then we'll have that term. Subtract them and use triangle inequality. Yeah? Now, this is small if we will choose good enough. It is smaller than epsilon over 2. Now we can do this by the choice of delta for rational, since here all rational, yeah? If we take delta of Rn, so we will enumerate all rationals, and take here, for example, if it's epsilon over 2 or epsilon over 4, it's better. So it, what is this? It is epsilon. Now 2n plus 2, if you want to have here 4, since we will take the sum. And here also we can take 1 over logarithm of Rn. You can do this if Rn is rational and positive. Okay? Rn is rational and positive. Questions? Then what, look, what do we have? If we have the delta xk is smaller than delta CK, CK, so even if all, not of course, all, we can't include all rationals, yeah? But in worst case, if you take summation for all rationals, then we will have, we will need cancel this corresponding logarithm and take summation for this stuff, so it is smaller than epsilon over 4 due to these two, okay? It is the same as we did for characteristic function. Now, but this integral, it is almost not the same, almost. That integral for the usual Riemann integral. It is partial sum for usual Riemann integral. This is smaller than epsilon over 2. There are some details indeed. So maybe let's consider these details as well. Strictly speaking, we have to consider these points as well, yeah? Because in this partition, this is zero. This is zero, since C0 is zero, we remove this interval, yeah? But here not, so what we will do with this interval? Here maybe it is the most difficult part, but let's consider this also. I remember that we integrate somehow in first lectures with you, consider improper Riemann integrals, and then we use these tricks. Now, we cannot enumerate irrationals, yeah? It's, we can't unfortunately take here some sequence of points since, and define delta at these points. It's, there is no guarantee that these points will be included in this partition. It should work for any partition, okay? So what to do? What to do? We can't enumerate irrational, the uncountable, but what can we do? We can do the following trick. So we have a function. We have a function fx, yes? And this is xk, xk plus 1 minus xk, just delta xk, yeah? This trick, we use this, by the way, with you, is to decompose that stuff, to construct a telescoping sum, so this is not f, it is ck, of course. It is f of ck, and here square root of xk plus 1 plus square root of xk, and here, the sum, it is square root of xk plus 1 minus square root of xk. Now look, if you take small enough delta as a function, positive of course, then we can arrange, then this stuff is bounded by absolute value, by some concrete value, the same, yeah? And then if you take, no problem with taking of the sum, since then, look, if we have, I will denote this by A, if you don't object, AK. If you have that A, all of AK less or equal than some constant C, yeah, then what do we have? Then we have that sum of modulus of F of CK, it is better to write, modulus is here, okay. Now we have that, this sum, F of CK, and here delta xk is smaller. I put modulus in front of, I estimate in corresponding way, and then I will have here c, and now it will be the sum of that one. So it will be square root of x. What is the last one? The last one, m. So this is m plus 1 minus square root of x1, okay? Indeed, we can neglect this one, xm plus 1, it is smaller than, let's summate to m. And then it will be smaller than c square root of delta 0. It is as small as we want, since we can choose delta 0 at the beginning very small. So we can use this trick. Why can we do this? For our case, we have logarithm, the function of the type logarithm x, and here the function of the type 2 square root of x, since if we take small, I don't want to write all in details, it's possible to do, since this is something as 2 square root of x. And this will be smaller than, if you want, we can estimate definitely 3. We can write that f of ck, and here the corresponding square root plus square root, it is smaller than that one. But this goes to zero again by L'Hopital rule. Since it goes to zero, we can estimate this easily from above. That is, we can take at the beginning, let delta zero be such that, since here we have that x is smaller than delta zero, we consider this only near the zero, such that logarithm x, 3 square root of x is smaller than any number, 1 over a million, etc. For example, smaller than 1. Okay, please your questions. This is long problem maybe, but I gave you if you found something like this, to eliminate this rational, then you, as you can see, I gave you some, not full grade, but more than half. Okay, please, your questions. Be careful. We can, by the choice of the C0 as 0, we can exclude neglect only the integral, but unfortunately not to delta 0, only to x1. Since in principle, this partition can be of any kind. Only we need that this delta xk, delta xk is smaller, this distance increment of x is smaller than this delta ck. Hmm? You take some function, x squared for rational, 0 for rational, or x cubed for irrational, and show that it is integrable in general Riemann sense. Okay? The second problem that I want to consider with you, was maybe the most interesting problem in the midterm. And this was generalization of nice problem from book of Foran, yeah, that we considered with you in class. I like this problem. And so I decided to generalize it and give you in the midterm. This is problem number three. So, at the beginning, let us recall the nice problem from Foran, yeah? Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4. This is usual counter set, This is problem from Foran. So this is 1 over 3, this is 1 over 9, this is 2 over 3, etc. Okay, this is 8 over 9. The problem Foran was the following. There are two sets, absolutely almost the same as in our homework only another counter set. The first set was the set of the centers of removed interval in this counter procedure. Yeah? We can write them explicitly. This is 1 over 2, this is 1 over 6, this is 5 over 6, etc., etc. You can do this, yeah? You can write this, find some formula. It's not so important. Now, the problem was to show that the first set, let's denote the set A. So once more, A, it is centers of deleted intervals, belongs to G delta. It is G delta set. Of course, it's countable. Not all countable sets are G delta. We understand with you that set of rational is not G delta. Yeah? Is not G delta. Any countable set is F sigma, but not any countable set is G delta. Now look. Why it is G delta? This is first part of the problem. And the second part of the problem, I don't remember if we've considered left end points or right end points, not so important. Let's, as in our midterm, we will consider with you left end points of the intervals. And these are points for the set B. These are points for the set B. So this is B1, B2, etc., etc. This is B1, B2 in natural enumeration, B3, B4. So there are something here. Yeah? And the set B, once more, set of left endpoints. Wait a minute. It was for deleted intervals. It's not so important. So in Foran, consider it the left endpoints for deleted intervals, but we can take this also points of basic intervals. Let's call them basic intervals, basic counter intervals. Intervals, it's just intervals that will give us this counter set. It is not G delta. So we solved with you this problem in class, okay? Now, what was the idea? What is the principal difference? The principal difference between set A and set B, that the points of set A, of course, here it's natural to consider, decompose on points of different levels. So we have point of first level, first 2 points of second level, 4 points of third level, etc. Yeah? The principal difference that the points of one level, of any level, they are distant from points of all next levels, okay? So here we can very easily take integral, for example, with the length 1 over 3, 1 over 3, we can take, not 1 over 3, 1 over 6, here we can take 1 over 6 such that this will not contain other points from B, from A, yeah? And here we can do this, and here we can do this. So if you can cover some countable set by open sets, countable union of internals, of course it is G delta. Why, of course? Since we have, there exists, I don't want to write this explicitly, it's very easy to see, to do this. There exists a G. What is G? It is countable union of intervals, so maybe it's better to write in this way. N from 1 to infinity, and here we have AN minus delta N, and AN plus delta N, where set A, it is just the sequence AN from 1 to infinity. Yes? Do you see this, yeah? We take just, this is A. Interval, first interval, this is second, third, etc., etc. It can be done. Hmm? I don't see enthusiasm on your face. No objections, yes? And this is open set, And now we will take, GM, GK. What is GK? It is absolutely the same, n from 1 to infinity, but we only will squeeze it, take length smaller. We take an minus 1 over k delta n an plus 1 over k delta n. So definitely this is again covering of A. If you decrease the length of interval, and then of course this any new interval will contain the corresponding point. Yes? And what is more? And if it is inside, we have that intersection of this gk also inside. But clearly that intersection of this GK, it doesn't contain any other points. It's only points of A. Since we take, of course, if you decrease the length, then in eventual intersection will contain only points of A. Therefore, this is G delta set, since just explicitly we have this representation, countable intersection. Okay? Please, this is simple part of the problem. The part of B, for B, it's not so simple, since here we can do this immediately to write this, but here we have to use another method, Baer theorem. We can use Baer theorem, but not for the line. Since in the line, the B is rarely set, and the whole Cantor set is rarely set, but we can use Baer theorem for Cantor set, So let's consider C as a Cantor set, yes? It is of the second category in itself. Of course, it's rare on the line, second category. Why? Because it's compact. Any compact set is complete. Any complete metric space is of the second category by Baer. Now, let's look at B. The most important thing here is to see that B is dense in this set C. Yes? Do you see this, yeah? Because what are points of Cantor set? It is the result of the, of course, I don't want to say that all points from here are some endpoints of basic intervals. But even if it is not endpoint of some intervals, it means that we will remove some intervals from that and from that side, and then we will approximate it by some endpoints. Left or right endpoints, if you want, yeah? And now, the standard method that we used with you, if we have that B is G delta, suppose that is G delta, then we have that C minus B is F sigma by duality, by the Morgan duality. If it is F sigma, we have that C minus B is of the first category. Why? Because since this is dense, by this density, if it is dense, then the complement is small in the sense of category. Okay? We use this many times, these arguments with you. And then we will have, since definitely B, of course B is the first category, it's countable, yeah? Then we will have that C is the first category in itself, This is a contradiction, since this is second category. Okay? Now, the problem that I suggested to you, it was just motivation, generalization, motivated by this nice problem of Foran. And this was just absolutely the same, but only for Cantor set, which is obtained by saving three intervals, but not two. So, what was A? A was a set of points A such that it is 1 over 2 plus the sum of k over 5n, yeah? And from 1 to infinity, to n capital, and n is natural. Sorry, I did not take but marker. And k belongs to the minus 1, 0, 1, okay? And the B was some points B, which were this just summation, yeah. It is n from 1 to n capital, kn, of course, here. And here we have kn over 5n. N is natural, and kn from 0 to 4. Unfortunately, I did not give you a hint. Of course, it was better to give a hint, as I understand now. So, a kind of to consider as a counter set. Consider these points as some special points for some counter set. So, if you will consider consider to sum these points, we will have the situation of the following type. This is 0, this is 1. Now we divide this integral not in 3 parts, but in 5 parts, yeah, 5 equal parts. This is 1 over 5, this is 2 over 5, this is 3 over 5, this is 4 over 5. No, so if you look, then we will, what do we have? We have this point, in the set B. In the set B, okay? These are B sets, yeah? Now, what are next? Next will be here, this one, the points of the next level, this one, etc., okay? So, if you will, no need to draw the intervals, but if you will do this, then you will see that it is not so. Of course, if you remember that problem. But what are points of A? Points of A, it is just the middles. If you take A 1 over 2, so it will be here, 1 over 2, then it will be 1 over 2, then it is this point, etc., etc. It will be just middle points of these deleted intervals. And once more, important difference between A and B is such that any point of A, it is some union of A, n, in natural way, we can take from 0 to infinity. So for 0, it is just 0.1 over 2. So what is A0? A0, it is 1 over 2. A1, it is the point that you can get from here. If you want to have disjoint, it is 1 over 2 plus minus 1 over 5, and you can continue. The important difference that for any point A from any AN, we have the distance. Of course, distance to previous is positive, since before we have only finitely many points. If you take finitely many different points, of course, they are distant, yeah? But it's important for the situation that distance to next is positive. We have the distance from the point A to union of A, k from n plus 1 to infinity is positive. But if it is positive, we can cover all these points by intervals, disjoint intervals. And then do the same, decrease the length of intervals, and we have G delta set. Okay? More simple part. Since in more difficult part, so this is G delta set. It's not G delta set. Why? For more difficult part, you have to understand that B should be considered as a subset of certain set C. Now set C, it is counter type set, but counter type of constructed by saving of three intervals on any step instead of one. Okay? Now, please, your questions. Okay, now let's look at this problem. I will give you solution, and then you will... questions about the first and the third. Second and fourth... Unfortunately, some of you did not solve the problem number 5. The problem number 5 was the most simple, so it's pity that you did not consider this. For 3, we have some functions. For 4, for problem number 4, the first mu one star of A, what is this? It is mu A. Mu A if A is measurable in the sense of Lebesgue, yeah? In the sense of Lebesgue. And we have that this is zero if A is not measurable in the sense of Lebesgue, yes? The question, whether or not is it mu one star is a outer measure. Not, why not? It's not monotone. It's not monotone. It's not, is not outer measure. Why it's not outer measure? Since it is not monotone. Monotone. What does it mean monotonicity? A inside of B, it should be M1A less or equal than M1B. But look, in this our situation, is it possible or not to, it's just your question as I understand, yeah? Is it possible or not to find B which is not measurable, yes? But A is measurable, but not only measure, of course we can take singleton, but such that measure of A is positive. Then of course we will have contradiction, yeah? Not contradiction, but the lack of this implication. Because it will be some positive number, it will be zero. Is it possible or not to take non-measurable set in the sense of Lebesgue and to find subset of positive measure inside? If you take Vitali set, that not. If you take Vitali set, the classical Vitali set that we considered with you, then what do we have? For Vitali set, we have the following, that if we have E inside of P and E is measurable, then we will have that measure of E is zero, since otherwise we can show, we did it with you, that we will have that there exists some delta such that this B zero delta is inside of E minus E, is inside of P minus P, but this is impossible since here there are a lot of rationals, okay? Now, but this is for Vitali set. And then, as I remember, we discussed with you what is the outer measure of Vitali set. It is some positive number. We can't, this exists by axiom of choice. We can't show this number explicitly. But what did I say? I said the following, that for any A, for any positive number, 1 million, 1 over 2, there exists set A, which is not Lebesgue measurable such that outer measure of this set is just given number A, given beforehand. So we can do this. We can take integral minus 1, 0, and here we consider this Vitali set. So please, this set is not measurable. The set is not measurable. Why set is not measurable? Since collection of measurable sets is sigma algebra. Since this set is measurable, if you suppose that this set is measurable, take intersection and then take the difference. If you take the difference, then we will have Vitali set, but it is not, okay? Since it's sigma algebra is closed with vector taking of the complement, the set is not measurable. But outer measure, of course, it's here positive and larger than 1, and of course it contains a subset. But we can do this not only, but again, we cannot control the outer measure of that one, since it's only larger than 1, that's all. Eh? But why can we do this? By the following argument, since what do we have? We have that we can take Vitali set, just usual Vitali set. We can take epsilon, which is the Lebesgue outer measure of this Vitali set exists and positive. It is very concrete positive number. Unfortunately, we can show this explicitly, since everything which is related to axiom of choice, it is usually some existence result, and that's all. They are not constructive. This is the problem, and this is the base of strong criticism to this axiom of choice. Okay, since only we can obtain some existence results, but now. Also, we can take, include interval, what do we need? A minus epsilon, minus A plus epsilon 0, together with Vitali set. The area, the measure, this is A minus epsilon, outer measure. Maybe it's not quite good. It's not quite good since they are not distant. So it's not additive, but Lebesgue outer measure is metric outer measure. So now let's take, for example, minus 2, oh, why it's so difficult? Yeah, let's take P union, and here 1, here we take 2, and here 2 plus A minus epsilon. Now look, the measure of that stuff is A minus epsilon, this interval, yes? The outer measure of that stuff, is epsilon. And now they are distant. If they are distant, Lebesgue outer measure, of course, is not additive, but it is metric. It is metric. What does it mean, metric? It means that if distance from A to B is positive, it follows that outer measure of A union B, it is the sum of outer measure A plus outer measure B. Okay, so it is a kind of additivity for distant terms of the union. So please, this this non-measurable set has outer measure given beforehand. Given beforehand, any for any positive number. Okay? We have no time to consider other problems, but maybe you have questions about that one, or first problem, part one, problem one, problem three.
If you take the union, we take the union.
Yeah.
Then we exclude the vital set, and it's to show.
Oh, yeah, this is measurable. So, of course, non-measurable set can contain some measurable parts.
But in this interval, aren't there points from the vital set also?
No. This Vitali, usual classical Vitali set. Usual classical Vitali set is constructed here, and for any epsilon, we can construct Vitali set inside of the interval zero epsilon, since here there are representatives of corresponding classes. And now there is some distant interval. So outer measure of the union, it is sum of outer measures, okay? No, I mean this here, P, it is classical usual Vitali set. Okay, another questions, we have 2 minutes for consultation. For last functions, of course, this is they're more or less simple. I mean, the second and the third functions, mu star k. Ah, the problem five. Okay, maybe I will not consider now. Late, you can come when we will look the your midterms. Then, then we will see how to do this.
Do you grade it all of them?
Of course, yeah. Yeah, I graded it Saturday. Okay, then we will finish if no questions.